Namaste and a very, very good morning to all of you. In this video, we'll be looking at a simple application of decision tree. Decision tree has many different applications and decision tree is used for a wide variety of purposes. Now, when we are talking about decision tree is usually compared with logistic regression. There are three distinct features about decision tree. The first being that it is a non-parametric approach, which means that it does not make any distributional assumptions about the data and such things. Second biggest advantage of decision tree is that it is very, very simple to use. And the third big advantage of decision tree is that you require you will be spending very less time in data pre-processing, data cleaning and such things because decision tree can handle missing values as well, right? Fourthly, decision tree is very, very simple, and therefore even layman, you don't need to be exactly be a statistician and understand the nuances of the algorithms to run decision tree. So simple to use, very, very simple to use, handles mixed data type. It supports mixed data type, which means that your data type, your dependent variable and your independent variables as well. They can be a scale variable. They can be a nominal variable. They can be ordinal variable. You can take it. Thirdly, there are no underlying distributions which we assume. We are not assuming any underlying distribution as far as the data is concerned. Fourthly, very, very important, less time as far as pre-processing of the data is concerned. Data cleaning and such things is not a big obstacle as far as decision tree is concerned, right? So these are some of the big advantages of decision tree. Decision tree is a very, very popular algorithm in banking setup because many times not just in banking setup, even in other entities like telecom sector and such areas, decision tree is widely used. Let us say you have a person who has taken a loan, he is not repaid, right? You might have burnt your hands by trusting wrong individuals. In future, you do not want to make the same mistake, which means in future, you want to understand the credit worthiness of an individual, right? What is the ability of a person to repay a debt, right? In other words, you are interested in knowing whether a person with certain characteristics, demographic details, and his past behavior, financial transactions, and such things, whether he is going to default after taking amount from you, right? So if you are in a position to forecast well in advance that individual X has more of a tendency to default, you may not want to pay any amount at all in the first place, right? On the other hand, if a person's ability to repay a debt is very, very high, if there is a good chance that he's going to take some amount and he's going to repay at a later stage, you can definitely go forward and give him whatever amount that he's seeking or what amount you think deserves, right? So in any case, you are interested in identifying the credit worthiness of an individual, right? So this is a case study which will basically talk about the credit risk of an individual, right? To do this, let me just pull a very, very simple data set. I'll be going to File, Open Data. You have credit risk analysis. Please click on this and choose the option Open, right? You quickly see a new data set pop up. This is basically the credit rating of an individual. You have a few bad credit. The first individual is a bad credit risk. His age is around 36 years, medium salaried person. He has around 5 or more credit cards, right? He has done his college, and the number of car loans that he has is more than 2, right? Second individual is a lot younger than the first one. He's around 21 years, middle income person. He has 5 or more credit cards, finished his college, and he has more than 2 car loans, right? You may be seeing only bad credit risk. Yes. If I scroll down, what you will see is you'll also see a lot of good credit risk individuals as well, right? Some of these people looks like they're a slightly older set of customers, and his income level is that he's in the medium income class, less than 5 credit cards, and education of the person is high school, and customer's car loans. How many car loans has he had? He has none or one, zero or one, right? Now, all these are basically demographic details of the customer and some past behavior, right? You have got demographic details and past transaction details and such things, which can be considered as the input variables. And this variable, credit history, credit rating of an individual, can be considered as a dependent variable. Remember, when you're doing a decision tree, it is an example of what is called as a supervised learning technique. I repeat, it's an example of a supervised learning technique. In a supervised learning technique, you have a dependent variable, you have a set of independent variables as well, right? You have a set of independent variables and a predefined class. That predefined class can be called as a dependent variable. This has to be differentiated from your traditional segmentation technique, right? Maybe you're using a two-step cluster analysis or a k-means cluster analysis. Those are all segmentation technique. They are referred to as unsupervised learning techniques. Here we are referring to decision tree as a supervised learning technique, right? Now, I can take this as the dependent variable, the rest of the variables as my input variables. I can go to the Analyze menu. To do a decision tree, go to the Analyze menu. Choose the option Classify. Right, you have many different techniques here. You have approximately 8 different techniques here. You can choose the option Tree here. Classify and say Tree. Right. Now, it throws open a new window. This is a new window. It expects a dependent variable and a set of independent variable. The past credit rating of an individual can be considered as a dependent variable. The remaining variables, right? Age, income level, number of credit cards, education, car loans, all these variables can be considered as independent variables. You can include as many variables as possible here, but for the purposes of simplicity, I've just taken 5 variables here, right? Very, very simple variables, which are easy to understand. You can take any number of variables here. And as I told you, you can include mixed data type. As you can see here, one of the variables, age, is a scale variable. Second variable, income, is an ordinal variable. The remaining variables are nominal variables, right? So decision tree has this beautiful property wherein you can take mixed data type. And even when it comes to dependent variable, you can it can handle mixed data type. A big, big advantage as far as decision tree is concerned. The algorithm that is used at the back end is what is called as CHAID algorithm. CHAID, right? If you just click on the drop-down menu, you have other algorithms as well, like CART, Quest, Exhaustive CHAID, right? Exhaustive CHAID, CART, Quest. I'm not going to be talking about these three algorithms in today's presentation. I'll just be sticking to CHAID. Now, what is CHAID? CHAID stands for Chi-Square Automatic Interaction Detection, right? I repeat, it stands for Chi-Square Automatic Interaction Detection, right? The decision tree will be constructed based on the association, right? It is going to look for the relationship between a particular segment and the dependent variable, right? If there is a high degree of association, that particular variable will be used, high degree and a significant relationship. If there is a low association, that particular variable will not be used. It will be thrown away, right? So based on the degree of association, the decision tree will be constructed, right? Very, very simple algorithm. Anybody can use it, right, to just get a feel of what is going on in the data set and how can you sort of profile, right? How can you profile bad credit risk and compare it with good credit risk, right? So in future, if you have a person who has bad credit characteristics, you might not want to entertain him. That is the entire purpose behind doing a decision tree. Remember, I have not split the data set as training and testing, which is the conventional machine learning way of doing it. I just want to show you I just want to give you a high-level perspective about how a decision tree operates. So I'm just running this analysis on the entire data set. You can just click on the option OK. Decision tree gives you some basic model summary, right? You can just ignore this. This is the tree diagram. This particular tree diagram is not in a very readable format. So you might want to zoom it. So I'll double click, right? And in the zoom option, you can just choose 100% or 200% is also okay, right? So that you can just get a better perspective. You can see here, this is how the decision tree looks like. You have the dependent variable, right? This is the dependent variable. This is coming right at the top, right? It looks like a person's head here, right? This is the dependent variable. It is just showing the distribution of the dependent variable. Approximately 41% of them are bad credit risk in individuals. They're a bad credit risk in this data set. And remaining 58.6% of the individuals, roughly around 59% of them, are good credit risk individuals, right? So we have a sufficient, we have a healthy sample of bad credit risk to make a decision, right? Now, this is as far as you can just compare it to a person's head here, right? And you see a vertical line here. And this is comparable to a person's neck, right? And it says income level. So income level is identified to be the first best predictor in identifying and classifying whether a person is bad credit risk or good credit risk. The question is, how did it come to this conclusion that income level is the first best predictor to classify an individual as bad credit risk or good credit risk? The answer is very, very simple. Look at this chi-square association. It is looking at the association, the degree of chi-square association between the dependent variable and a segment of the independent variable, right? So chi-square is 662, right? And the p-value is quite significant for income level. Now, when you look at this particular variable, look at the low income class, right? If I just scroll to the right side, you have the medium income class. To the extreme right, you have the high income class as well. It is shown as greater than medium. Now, as far as the low income class is concerned, just study the behavior of low income class. Let me just scroll down. Now, insofar as the low income class is concerned, you have 82%, right? Big, big chunk here. Within the low income class, 82% of them happen to be bad credit risk. Only 18% of them happen to be good credit risk, right? Quite a significant number of people in the low income class happen to be bad credit risk, right? But I cannot stop here because this is not terminating here. This is just a decision node. It helps me make a decision. This is not a terminal node. I have to go all the way to the last box, to the last node, before I can pick up an important role. So low income class definitely indicates bad credit risk, high proportion of bad credit risk here. If you further scroll down, what do you see here? Look at number of credit cards. This has been identified to be the second best predictor. First best predictor is income class. Second best predictor is number of credit cards. And the chi-square association is significant here because the p-value is smaller than 0.05 and the chi-square value is 132, right? If you look at this, there is a bifurcation here. It has made two different groups here. One group, it comprises of those people who have five or more credit cards. The second group consists of those people who have less than five credit cards. So if a person belongs to the low income class, and please look at the split on the right side, person belongs to the low income class and he has less than five credit cards, the majority category here is good, right? 61% of them happen to be good. So this is a terminal node. You can pick up this as a rule and you can just use this for scoring for future data sets and statistics, correct? Look at the other side. Person belongs to the low income class and the number of credit cards is five or more, right? He belongs to low income class. He also has five or more credit cards. Very, very dangerous behavior you're seeing. 90% of them happen to be bad credit risks, right? 90% of them happen to be bad credit risk. Watch out for the sample size here. It is as you go deeper and deeper within the tree, you'll obtain lesser and lesser sample, right? You don't want to make a decision with very, very few sample with a box which has very, very less sample size. You want at least a healthy sample size here. But what I'm able to say is low income class, number of credit cards, five or more, is a dangerous sign. It's a worrying sign because it's highly indicative of people taking a loan and not repaying it, right? Now, finally, what do I have? what I have is basically age, right? A person belongs to the low income class, possesses 5 or more credit cards, and his age is less than 35 years. If his age is less than 35 years, right, he's relatively younger. So 95% of them tend to be bad credit risk. Right? 95%, right? So you have picked up a very, very important decision-making rule here, a decision-making criteria, which says people belonging to the low income class possessing 5 or more credit cards, right? If they in the past have had 5 or more credit cards and their age is less than 35 years, a very, very dangerous sign. This is a terminal note, so I have to be very, very careful with this because you make decisions based on the terminal node. What happens to the other category? That is, if a person's age is greater than 35 years, 78% of them happen to be bad here, right? So here 78%, but here 95%. So all these are very, very important decisions, rules. You might want to just take these rules, have a discussion with the client. You might have an internal brainstorming session because many of these rules you might further want to qualify. You might want to use some of them. You might not want to use some of these things. But this is what a decision tree can do in a very, very simple, in a very effective manner. It just picks up all the rules. It keeps on slicing and dicing of the segments unless it can just drill down and point out and give you something which you can act upon, right? So I've just looked at one set of rules here. If I just scroll down, I made a decision about low income class. Now it'll be very interesting to study what is happening as far as the middle income group is concerned, right? In the middle income group, it has again said that it is again saying that the number of credit cards is the second important predictor, right? A person can have 5 or more credit cards, right? Medium income class, 5 or more credit cards. The majority category here happens to be bad, right? Finally, it has identified again age as the third best predictor, right? It is making 4 buckets based on age, less than 28, 28 to 33, 33 to 45, 45 and above, right? Look at each of these boxes, right? Middle income class, right? 5 or more credit cards, age is less than 28. A lot of people happen to be, bad credit risk, approximately 80% of them, right? Which is a big number, happen to be bad credit risk. Middle income class, 5 or more credit cards, ages between 28 and 33 years, right? What's happening is around 56% of them happen to be bad credit risk. Same flow, right? Middle income class, 5 or more credit cards, and then ages between 33 and 45. Here, the majority category happens to be good, right? Which means that basically in the middle income class, people possessing 5 or more credit cards, if the age is greater than 33 years, right? Mostly people tend to be good, right? If the age is less than 33 years, mostly people tend to be belonging to bad credit risk, right? You can similarly make a decision for the other group as well, right? That is a high income category as well. You can just make a decision quickly and you can just see for yourself. Most of them tend to be in the good category, if I'm right. Most of them tend to be in the good category in the high income class, correct? So this is how you can identify which are your key drivers of credit risk analysis, which are the top 3 drivers: income category, number of credit cards, and age. Very, very interestingly, if you remember, I had included other important variables as well. That is number of car loans and education levels, right? You don't see these 2 variables appearing anywhere here, which means that these 2 variables do not have a high degree of relationship with bad credit risk or good credit risk, right? Right? Because they don't have a significant relationship, those 2 variables are not included in the model building process, right? Now, this is a very, very important visual aid. Now, if you want, you can just change the orientation, right? I was just looking at it from a top down. For presentation purposes, you can just change the orientation. Now, you can just scroll to the extreme left, right? You can see the dependent variable here. Now, you'll be going from left to right, correct? Now, if this is how you want to present the results to the client, you can just do that as well, right? It is just the same graph, same decision tree, but we'll be looking at it from left to right as well. So I particularly like this because it makes reading the graph very, very simple, right? If you don't want to show this in the form of a table, what you can do is you can just, these three help you with, give you a lot of control as far as orientation is concerned. One is top down, second one is left to right. You can also have right to left, right? Instead of these numbers here, if you wanted to display a chart, a simple bar chart and such things, you can just click on the bar chart. Look at this, how beautifully it just SPSS constructs the bar chart. Here, you can just look at the length of the bar, right? Clearly, you can see the red colored bar, which corresponds to good credit risk. The sample size for that is higher as compared to the blue bar. So based on the length of the bar, based on the bar chart also, you can make appropriate decisions, right? Sometimes the clients absolutely love this kind of a presentation because you're not making them work hard to interpret this, right? You can just see which is the modal class here, either the bad credit risk or the good credit risk, right? So you can just look at number of credit cards, 5 or more. You can clearly see that the blue colored category is dominating here. So this is the modal class. So this is the majority class here, right? So you can interpret it through the charts as well. Now, if you say, I want to look at both the chart, I want to look at both the tabular view here as well as give me the graphical view, you can do that as well. In the first portion, it gives you the numerical representation. Below this, you can also see the graphical representation, right? This is just for presentation purposes. You can just play around with this. You can just change the zoom and such things. Now, I'll just close this. Right now, you have picked up certain rules and certain important patterns from the data set, right? Question is, should I use this in a data set, right? Now, with any decision tree, you can always misclassify an individual, right? That is, a person can misclassify. He may be actually a good credit risk, but based on the model characteristics, you may misclassify him as bad, and vice versa. Bad credit risk may be misclassified as a good credit risk. So you should always look at two metrics here. One is, what is the risk of misclassifying an individual? Here, the estimate is 0.189. Right, which means the roughly there is 18%. If you round it off, it becomes 19. Roughly, there is a 19% probability that you misclassify an individual. Right? Question is, do you want to take this? Do you have the risk appetite to take this? Right? What is your risk appetite? That is the question here. 20 out of 100 individuals who have been classified are likely to be misclassified, which automatically means that 80 out of the 100 individuals will be classified in the correct group, right? Now, below this, people usually pay attention to the confusion matrix. This is popularly called as confusion matrix, right? People pay attention to this. Look at this. This is very, very important. In the row, you have the observed category, right? This is the observed category. You have the bad and the good credit risk. And in the column, you have the predicted category, which is again bad and good. Predicted by whom? Predicted by the model that we have just now built, which is the decision tree, right? Now, what you have to look at is basically the diagonal elements, right? You have to look at the diagonal element. Why the diagonal element? Because the diagonal element basically represent the correct classification, and the off-diagonal elements here, right, represent the incorrect classification, right? Now, bad to bad, observed is bad, and the predicted is also bad, right? So which means that our model is able to correctly classify 70% of the bad credit risk in the correct group itself, right? Observed is bad, predicted is also bad, right? Out of roughly around 1,020 individuals, right? Out of roughly 1,020 individuals, 714 bad credit risks have been correctly identified and they have been put in the correct category. So my model accuracy in identifying the bad credit risk is 70%. Now, what about the good credit risk? When it comes to the good credit risk, right, 160 have been misclassified because they are good, but the model is saying that one they've been misclassified as bad credit risk. So 1,284 individuals have been good, and my model is also correctly predicting them as good, right? So in identifying good credit risk individuals, my model is accurate to the extent of 89%, right? So usually you see this tendency wherein you may not be interested in identifying what is the character, what is the profile of good credit risk, because they're relatively harmless. But you are more interested in identifying the characteristic of bad credit risks, right? So bad credit risks are harmful. I don't want too many individuals to take away the amount and not be able to repay, right? So I may be interested in one of these two categories, not both, right? The dangerous category is the bad category. So in identifying bad credit risk, my model is accurate to the extent of 70%. And if you look at the overall average, 81.1, if you round it off, roughly around 82% is the overall percentage of accuracy, right? So we have built a decision tree model. 82% is the overall percentage of accuracy in identifying bad credit risk. 70% is the accuracy in identifying good credit risk. 89% is the accuracy, right? Remember, if you want to operationalize this in a real-time scenario, you might want to split the data set into training and test. You might want to build the model on training, get the output, and then once you see the output for advanced level calculation, you might want to predict it for test. And then you look at what is the percentage of correct classification in the test data set. That is the right way to do this. And this is how people do it in a real-time scenario. But I've not split this as training and testing. I've just run this on the entire data set because my purpose was to just show you how a decision tree works. There are two other important points which I wish to make here. One is bad credit risk and good credit risk, right? It's always debatable because you need to brainstorm and make a decision here. Now, two cases here. One is you may be in the market as a company. You are in the market for, let's say, 20, 25 years, right? Since you're in the market for 20, 25 years, you do not want too many bad credit risk. There, many times, bad credit risk people happen to be the focal point, right? Because they are basically robbing the efficiency at the end of the day, right? They are high-risk customers. I don't want too many high-risk customers and such things. I want good customers. So if you're in the market for 20, 25 years and you have a reputation, if you're concerned about reputation, bad credit risk and such things, you might want to be serious. You might want to penalize them heavily when it comes to bad credit risk. On the other hand, think of another scenario. You might just be a startup. Since you're a startup, you are more interested in increasing your customer database, right? So you might you might be lenient as far as these models and such things are concerned, because your main goal is to expand the customer base when you're a startup, right? So this is a slightly tricky decision. You might want to discuss and debate which of the two categories you are going to treat seriously. But mostly, for all practical purposes, it's the bad credit risk which are taken seriously, because and you might want to penalize them more than your good credit risk. So this is about decision tree. Remember the advantages of decision tree. I'm just summarizing it. It's a non-parametric approach. It is very, very simple and easy to use. You will not be spending too much of time in data cleaning and such things. There are many, many different algorithms. One of the algorithms that I've shown here is CHADE. So these are the four important points about decision tree. I thank you for watching my video. I request you to like and subscribe. I request you to subscribe to my channel and like my videos. I'll see you in my next video. Thank you very much.